I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
The hour is coming and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live.
We brought nothing into this world. It is certain we shall carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living.
Our Savior Christ Jesus abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel.
I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell.
Because I live, you will live also.
And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain, for the first things are passed away.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The hymn, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven, to His feet your tribute bring. Let us pray. God of grace and power and truth, you are the God of our lives. You are the source of our true happiness and the only source from where we can find real consolation and lasting hope in times of need. At all times, O God, when we truly seek you, we find strength and meaning and hope. So we pray that you would make yourself known to us again as we gather here in this hour of worship. While we cannot fathom fully the mysteries of life and death, enable us to be encountered and lifted by your divine presence, by your love, by your comfort, by your strength, by your grace. Remind us even now that you are the giver of all good gifts, and that you do not give as the world gives, for what you give you do not take away forever. And what is yours is ours always, if we are yours. And life in you is life eternal. Lift us, therefore, strong Son of God, that we may see beyond the challenges of this moment, when we are beset with a sense of loss and grief. We ask you to speak to us your gracious word of promise, that we may be lifted above the strain and the stress to experience the beauty of the peace that your presence brings. Draw us closer to yourself, that we may know ourselves nearer to our beloved Uncle Lindley, your servant, your son, whom you have called to yourself. And while you prepare a place for us, dear God, prepare us both for that place and for living each day with you, so that where you are, we may be too. Accept the worship that we offer. Enable us to hear your message of death overcome and life renewed, that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light and blessedness of an eternity with you. And in the midst of the changes and the chances of life and of this world, we may rest in the sure knowledge that nothing, nothing present, nothing to come, not even death, can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Wherefore, in never ceasing prayer, our souls to thy continual care we faithfully commend, assured that thou through life shalt save and show thyself beyond the grave, our everlasting friend. Amen. We are met in this solemn moment to commend Lindley Conrad Rankine into the hands of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who sent his Son Jesus Christ to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone we have salvation. Let us then recall to mind the life of our deceased brother and father in the faith, and in humble trust hear the words of Holy Scripture. I invite the Reverend Dr. Wainford McFarlane, Secretary of the Jamaica Methodist District Conference, to read the obituary.
Obituary for the Reverend Lindley Conrad Rankine. Lindley Conrad Rankine was born on June 11, 1925, in Stewart Town in the parish of Trelawney, Jamaica. It was a warm summer's day when his parents, William James and Minnie Rankine, welcomed and cherished him as their fifth son. His brothers were Conroy, Leslie, Barry, Leroy, and Clarence. At the age of 2 years, Lindley's father moved his family to Nylers Hill, Port Antonio, in the parish of Portland, as it was thought that they would do better there. Lindley spent most of his childhood and teenage years in Portland, where he had his share of mischief and quickly acquired the nickname Scotty, the genesis of which may never be known. Young Lindley received his early education at Bonebrook Infant School, Crossroads Primary School, and Titchfield High School, all in Port Antonio. This was during the Second World War, 1939 to 1945. In 1942, at age 17, he left Titchfield High School to become a volunteer in the war and enlisted in the Royal Air Force, RAF, service number 713423. On April 11, 1944, he entered camp at Palisades for military training and then went on to England. As was customary in those days, the troops traveled by ship via New York to pick up other soldiers along the Hudson River. Lindley landed in Greenock, Scotland in November 1944. And to complete his military training, he was then sent to Filey, North Yorkshire, which site was actually the holiday camp for Butlins, a large company. Because of its location, it was used as a military training base from 1939 to 1945. Leaving Port Antonio to live in England was quite a big change, especially as it related to the climate. Butlin's Holiday Camp, as the name suggests, was built for persons who wished to vacation when the weather was warm. Heat was provided only by way of water pipes in the roof. One night, young Lindley was so cold that the only thing he took off was his forage hat. He slept in his full uniform and boots, along with 7 blankets. It was at such times that he felt homesick. However, he was thankful to God that despite his various attempts to be sent back home, he eventually settled down and reaped the benefits of a career in the RAF. Lindley Rankine worked as part of the ground staff in the offices of many bases, including Spanhoe in Northamptonshire and Felixstowe in Suffolk. His last assignment was at Downham Market, a town in Norfolk, England. After the war had ended, he was discharged from the RAF, and as the custom was at the time, he was given the option of either land purchased for him in Jamaica or staying in England and have the RAF fund further studies. He chose the latter. Furthering his education entailed attending an English institution, Wednesbury College in the West Midlands. Eventually, Lindley Rankine took the train from Surrey to London, then to Birmingham. However, having arrived in West Bromwich, the surprise was that Wednesbury College was not open at that late hour. Not knowing what to do, he began walking. He saw a man drinking at a bar and related to him his story. The gentleman took him to the nearest police station in West Bromwich to see if they could assist by finding him a place to stay. The police response was that they could only keep him if he had committed himself. Otherwise, they could not help. The gentleman therefore took him to his own home in Wednesbury, offered him a settee for the night and a breakfast the following morning. Lindley then proceeded to the college easily, as the gentleman's home was nearby. This noble gesture on the part of a complete stranger left an indelible impression upon him, given the reports of racism that were then quite common. After finishing studies, Lindley Rankine worked and returned to Jamaica. However, he subsequently made the decision to return to England and worked in the town of Feltham, West London. He felt called to the ministry and attended Cliff College in Sheffield. Historically, Cliff College, or Cliff as it is known, has been well known as a Methodist training college for those wishing to engage in mission and evangelism. This institution obviously made a profound impression upon him, based on the particular direction his life was subsequently to take. Having spent a year at Cliff, he requested to be sent back to Jamaica to minister to his own people. Lindley Rankine, on his return to Jamaica, was eventually accepted as a candidate for the ministry of the Methodist Church in the Caribbean and the Americas, MCCA. At the time, Methodism in Jamaica was under the direction of the British Conference. He received his seminary training and ministerial formation at Kenwood Theological College in Kingston. This was from 1955 through to 1959. Upon completion of his studies, he was appointed as a probationer in the St. Elizabeth Circuit, and in 1961 ordained to the Ministry of Word and Sacraments. It was during 1958 that he met the love of his life, Yvonne Louise Street. The wedding took place on November 26, 1960 at 3 p.m. at Lindhurst Methodist Church. The Lord blessed their union with three children, Lindley Jr. and twin girls, Angela and Andreen. They later adopted Mark Robinson. As the years unfolded, they were further blessed with nine grandchildren and one great-grandson. It was noticeable how at his first assignment at Mountainside in the St. Elizabeth Circuit, 1959 to 1965, under the supervision of the Reverend Denham Mullings, Mrs. Rankine joined her husband in ministry. Throughout their life as a married couple, they were a team. The Rankines were very involved in the first independence celebrations of the island in the parish of St. Elizabeth in 1962. The Saturday night market and agricultural meetings were not off limit for Reverend Rankine, as he connected easily with community residents. He always tried to be practical. For example, on a number of occasions, he substituted a bicycle for his car when the terrain was too rugged for the vehicle. From Mountainside, he went to Black River, it being his first appointment as superintendent minister. After St. Elizabeth, Reverend Rankine was assigned to the Lucy Circuit, 1965 to 1971. Then it was on to Morant Bay in the St. Thomas Circuit, 1971 to 1977. Followed by Port Antonio, 1977 to 1985. Port Antonio was significant as far as his three children, Lindley Jr., Angela, and Andreen were concerned, for they all attended Titchfield High School, his alma mater. During his tenure in Port Antonio, Reverend Rankine also served in Annotto Bay, 1979 to 1985. Then St. Anne's Bay, 1985 to 1987. Brownstone Edmondson, 1987 to 1988. And Montego Bay Mount Ward, 1988 to 1991. While in Montego Bay, Reverend Rankine headed the Methodist Church's hurricane relief effort to the western section of the island in the wake of Hurricane Gilbert in 1988. This involved him and his team receiving aid supplies by plane and arranging for their distribution. In 1991, having superannuated, his willingness to give oversight to the Montego Bay, Mount Ward and Lucy circuits, 1991 to 1992, eased a serious stationing dilemma. Reverend Rankine was a disciplined person and well known for his punctuality. This was seen in every aspect of his life. For example, his family knew that when he set a time to leave home, everyone had to be in the car or else he would leave whoever was not ready. There were many times his children completed getting ready in the car. Reverend Rankine spent his entire ministry stationed in the Jamaica district. As an ordained minister of the Methodist Church, in the Caribbean and the Americas, he was privileged to travel to many other countries to preach or to attend training courses. He visited England, Venezuela, Tortola, Aruba, and Dominica. Given his interest in mission and evangelism, he undertook mission trips to the United States of America, as well as facilitated Methodist Church work teams from the USA undertaking mission projects in Jamaica. This venture with mission teams sometimes bore fruit that benefited his congregants, as, for example, the case of a young man who received a scholarship to study at Indiana State University, USA. Reverend Rankine was an engaging liturgist and impressive preacher. Who could forget those sermons that he went at great lengths to prepare and deliver? His piano accordion was his partner in ministry. And although he played the piano, it was the accordion that took the main focus. With it, he played lively choruses, especially during open-air meetings. Indeed, his competence as a musician enhanced many of his evangelistic services. With God's help, he brought many to surrender to Christ's claim upon their lives. He always sought to get the youth involved. He loved young persons and was known for his domino, football, and athletic prowess, as he was often heard challenging the young persons to a race. He was a beach lover and a strong swimmer who ensured that all his children could swim. Where feasible, he encouraged the work of the Boys Brigade, which helped to instill much needed discipline in young lives. Wherever stationed, Reverend Rankine was involved not solely in what is traditionally regarded as church work, but was equally enmeshed in social work. He did much work with the Agricultural Society, which, interestingly, reaped benefits for his congregations insofar as harvest contributions were concerned. Of interest, too, is the fact that Reverend Rankine loved ripe bananas, a love which seemed to intensify, especially in his very senior years. Generally, because of his social involvement, he was regarded not simply as a Methodist minister, but a community minister. In recognition of his work, he was made a Paul Harris Fellow by the Rotary International Club and was given a City of Montego Bay Award. Reverend was a minister to all and went beyond denominational boundaries. To his members, he was simply Uncle Lindley and was known to have nieces and nephews from 0 to 100 years. His far-reaching ministry focused on evangelism and youth. His many visits to the aged and housebound could not be forgotten. His long ministry included many unusual requests. On a few occasions, he officiated in weddings on the beach and would appear in what he describes as full regalia, despite the fact that the guests were dressed according to the beach-themed dress code. After giving faithful service to the MCCA, Reverend Rankine superannuated in 1991. His interest in the work of the church never wavered, evidenced in his ongoing role as a supernumerary minister. He spent his latter years in Brownstown, St. Anne, Mandeville, and Mandeville, Manchester. Lindley Conrad Rankine died on the 14th day of March, 2024, in the 99th year of his life and the 66th of his ministry. May his soul rest in peace and perpetual light shine upon him. Amen.
Through the love of God our Savior, all will be well. Free and changeless is his favor. All is well. Precious is the blood that healed us. Perfect is the grace that sealed us. Strong the hand stretched forth to shield us. All must be well. Let us stand for the hymn.
Come to that point in our worship where we express our gratitude for the ministry of the Reverend Lindley Conrad Rankine. There will be expressions of tribute in song and also in word. Please note that there is the booklet, which contains quite a number of tributes. I mean, if we were to give everybody an opportunity to speak during this service, this would continue for a week. But thankfully, we are limited in time. We invite, first of all, Mr. Leroy Heron to give his selection. This will be followed by tributes from the Manchester Circuit, the Port Antonio Circuit, and the family will give its tribute. And following this, Canon Grace Jervis will give her tribute in song, and then we'll have the tribute in flowers.
What a wonderful thing, a very wonderful thing, to be free from sin and a Christ within, to be made a joint heir with Jesus my Lord. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful thing.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters. If you notice on the program, it says Leroy Heron. But I am the company. We are family from Moran Bay. And Uncle Lindy formed a youth club in Moran Bay. And during that time, he also formed a band. And we are a part, or were a part of this band and youth club in Moran Bay. So here we are today, not youth anymore, but we are still here. And our memory for Uncle Lindy, and by extension, the Rankine family, will live on. So we are here to pay our small tribute to the Rankine family. God bless you.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul.
It is well.
It is well
with my soul.
It is well. It is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well.
It is well
with my soul.
With my soul.
It is well. It is well with my soul. And Lord, is the day when the faith shall be the sight, the clothes be rolled back as a scroll, the trumpet shall sound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. With my soul.
It is well.
It is well.
With my soul.
It is well. It is well. With my soul.
I stand here to bring tribute re Uncle Lindley, Conrad, Rankine, on behalf of the Manchester Circuit of Methodist People. Reverend, in all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, or he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Acts 20:35 was a verse quoted many times by Reverend Rankine. In a life dedicated to the service of God and humanity, Reverend Lindley Conrad Rankine, lovingly called Uncle Lindley, exemplified the profound wisdom of these words. He was a minister for over 60 years. He tirelessly devoted himself to spreading the message of love, compassion, and faith. His ministry was not merely a vocation, but a calling deeply rooted in his unwavering belief in the power of kindness and the transformative nature of spirituality. Reverend Rankine served the Manchester Circuit on two occasions, from 1994 to 1997, and again from 2002 to 2003. Throughout his service, Reverend Rankine touched the lives of countless members, offering solace in times of hardship, guidance in moments of doubt, and hope in moments of despair. He is remembered for his preaching, which resonated with authenticity and sincerity, reflecting a deep connection to God and an unyielding commitment to uplifting those around him. He was known for playing his accordion and working with the youth. He lived out the teachings of Christ with humility and grace. Beside him was this graceful and resourceful wife, Aunt Peggy, who complimented him in his ministry. As we reflect on Reverend Rankine's remarkable legacy, we are reminded not only of his dedication to God, but also of the impact he had on those he served. His life serves a testament of his faith, the importance of service, and the potential of love. He may no longer walk among us, but his spirit lives on in the countless lives he touched and the legacy of kindness and compassion he leaves behind. We bid farewell to a beloved servant of God, a true shepherd of his sheep, and a cherished friend to many who had the privilege of knowing him. Today, we take comfort in the knowledge that Reverend Rankine's legacy will continue to inspire us to live lives of great compassion, of faith and service. May he rest in eternal peace, knowing that he has fought the good fight, finished the race, and he has kept the faith.
Members of the clergy, family members of the late Lindley Rankine, friends. There are special people in our lives who will never leave us, even after they are gone. The Reverend Lindley Rankine was one such person. The Port Antonio Circuit was privileged to have had Reverend Lindley Rankine, affectionately known as Uncle Lindley, to serve as resident minister from September 1, 1977 to August 31, 1985. This period of 8 years made him the longest serving minister to date in our circuit. Like a shepherd, the Reverend guided the circuit with wisdom and encouragement. His sermons resonated deeply, always charging us to grow spiritually and inspired us to daily live the Christian life. We will not only remember his sermons, but always recall, before each sermon, he would approach the pulpit from the lectern, singing the hymn, "Master, speak, thy servant heareth." Two other favorite hymns of his were "Praise to our Redeeming Lord," and "The Right Hand of God is writing in our land." As he sung these hymns, he provided his own accompaniment on the accordion. He was an accomplished accordionist. And I can picture him now as he played that instrument. His whole being was into it. You could see him rocking from side to side as he played. I can just see him doing that now. He was really good at it. Uncle Lindley had an excellent relationship with the youth. During his tenure, all four churches in the circuit had vibrant youth groups, and some had Boy Scout troops. I can remember three boys from Fruitful Vale congregation were once selected to attend the Boy Scout Jamboree held in Trinidad and Tobago. The existence of these groups resulted in large number of youth in attendance at church each Sunday. Many of these young attendees embraced the Methodist faith and were eventually confirmed. And I can say I am one of those. As he worked with the youth, Uncle Lindley would organize monthly birthday parties and annual picnics across the circuit. He ensured that his own children participated in all these activities, and they even taught Sunday schools. Again, I can just remember him. And you know, lately I was thinking whether or not the circuit knew what kind of minister he was going to be when they bought a station wagon, a Hillman Hunter station wagon, for him to use. Because on picnic days, you could see Reverend Rankine, Uncle Lindley, coming into our areas, into Fruitful Vale, into Bloomfield, Port Antonio, and Obey. And he would pick up all youth, and he would make several trips. And he would, sometimes I wonder, we were probably lucky that we didn't run into a problem with the law. Because he would pack that car from front to trunk. We were all packed in, but not only just us, the pots and pans and firewood would all be packed in, and half we would go to either under the bridge at Eden, down in St. Margaret's Orange Bay, or in Port Antonio, and when it rains, in the Bloomfield Primary School. Reverend Rankine was a community icon. One of his remarkable traits was his ability to connect with people from all walks of life. He was not only a preacher behind the pulpit, but was a constant in their lives. Whenever you needed help, Reverend Rankine was that person you would go to. I can recall me leaving, graduating from Portland High School, was not satisfied with the amount of subject I got, GCE subject. I was talking to Reverend Rankin about it because he would follow me up, you know. Watch my progress. I had to report to him. I had to tell him what happened. And so he said, all right. He listened to my story and he went away, he went home. About probably 3 hours later, I saw the Illman Hunter car coming back into Bloomfield and I was wondering, this is not usual for Reverend Rankin to be coming in back at this time of the on a Sunday evening. But when the car drove up, I looked and it was not him who was the driver, but Junior Rankin. And Junior drove up to me and he handed me an envelope and it was addressed to the principal, Mr. Chin, at Titchfield High School. Reverend Rankin wanted me to further my education and he would do anything for that. I can also remember going to Fufuville on a Sunday morning to preach. When I got there, I told the congregation how Reverend Rankin came to visit us at Bloomfield. And somebody who is from Fufuville but not living there now said to me, what? He's still getting around? I said, of course he is. The person looked at me and he said, that is a good man, you know. And I listened. He said, I remember leaving Titchfield High School. Didn't have a job. Mentioned it to Reverend Rankin. Somehow Reverend Rankin went and he sought out a job. And he said to me, you have to go now for the interview. In those days, it was difficult, almost impossible, to get out of Fruitful Vale, to get to where you're supposed to go for that interview. Reverend Rankin looked at him, said to him, what you do? Just come up by the man's, sleep there with us for the night. He said he went and he slept there. Early in the morning, he said Reverend Rankin got up, made breakfast for him, then put him in that Illman Hunter, and half he went with him to the train station where he sent him off for the interview, and he never forget it. Yes. Reverend Rankin, Uncle Lindley, was also a part of the Jamaica Tourist Board Meet the People program. And that was a program which was a community group that had families hosting guests from the cruise ship, which used to visit Port Antonio at least once per month. Uncle Lindley, along with Aunt Peggy, would welcome these people, made them comfortable, and would serve them some of the best Jamaican food. I never forget it. These people would go to length to make anyone welcome, feel welcome and comfortable. Uncle Lindley was a stickler for time. Again, I can remember, I've never seen him late. He's always on time. Or he would be at church service like 15 minutes before the time. And one Sunday morning, we were supposed to have a Boy Scout parade. And Uncle Lindley was supposed to inspect the guard of honor. Well, at 10:45, he wasn't there. 11 o'clock, he wasn't there. This was strange, so I said to the boys, something is wrong. At 10:55, he turned up and he got out of the car. He said, boys, I'm so sorry. I had a flat tire on the road. So we knew, and I turned to the boys, I said, that's what I told you. This man has never been there. I've never seen him late. You know, so he always respects time. The Reverend Lindley Rankin had the unique gift of making persons feel seen, heard, and valued He has left an indelible mark in the life of the Port Antonio circuit, and he will be forever in our hearts. Nothing can ever take away a love that the art holds dear. Rest in peace, Uncle Lindley.
Connectional President Bishop Everell Galbraith, Jamaica President Bishop Christine Gordon Benghushi, Reverend Maxine Forrest Edwards, Superintendent of the Manchester Circuit, officiating ministers and other clergy, uncles, aunts, and friends, good morning. My brothers and sisters in Christ, do we grieve for those without hope? A thunderous no, as Daddy would say. We are Lindley Jr., Andrine, and Angela, who are very easy to tell apart the way they're dressed today. We apologize for Mark, who is unavoidably absent. My dad was loved by many people for many reasons. Today I'll focus on two of them. The first thing, that he was punctual. It seems as if his years in the Royal Air Force prior to the call of ministry had encouraged this. I never knew him to be late. He used to tell me, son, if you have to be at a 10 a.m. meeting, you should plan to be there 15 minutes before, because if you arrive at 10, you're late, and the meeting cannot start at 10. But if you arrive 15 minutes before, you will be in your seat at 10, and the meeting can start on time. The second is that Daddy was very forgiving. And having a son like me, he got a lot of practice. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you so much. So we are speaking in order of birth. So I'll go next, as I am a whole 3 minutes older than Andrine. We all receive unique gifts from God, and Daddy's gifts allowed him to connect with everyone he met while carrying out his ministry. He was passionate about the work of God and his family. Daddy's call to the ministry preceded us, his family. We lived in many places as directed by the church. The one rule we knew is that everywhere we went, the family went together. Daddy gave us spiritual support and encouraged us to make the best of each transfer. From we were very young, we saw Daddy worshiping God in spirit and in truth, and were led to do the same. Although we married persons in the ministry, none of us answered the call. to full-time ministry. Much of Daddy, however, lives in us, and it's never too late for a shower of rain. Daddy was a disciplinarian, as my brother alluded to. However, he had a serious sense of humor and was fun to be around. He was the perfect mix of discipline and fun. Daddy's pinches, tickles, last licks were a part of his ministry. He held youth and children dear to heart. Who wouldn't love a minister who played football, table tennis, took them on trips to the beach, hiked, showed movies on his reel-to-reel projector while mommy served popcorn? This discipline saw him spending 30 minutes most days on his stationary bicycle up to his 95th birthday. And as it was with church, home life was the same balance of fun and discipline. Very early, we noticed that Daddy was, well, let's put it this way, not as tall as the other daddies. This earned him the name Little Daddy, a name spoken in childhood innocence, but rooted in reality. Daddy accepted the name, which lasted many years.
When the grandchildren came along, they were the beneficiaries of Dad's love and fun. Stephanie, Georgia, and Tishura, Angelique, say that they are grateful for the many lessons that Daddy taught them. Of course, his stories of England and his time in the Royal Air Force were extremely excited as they learned about what it was to be alive during World War II, and definitely what it was to be a part of the military forces. They continue to say that Granddad was their Santa Claus. Every Christmas, he put on his Santa Claus hat and distributed presents. And of course, their personal accordion player, as they put it. Chad and Mailing, Matthew and Jonathan, say that Granddad's legacy is not limited to his family, but will live on through the lives of all those who he touched. Granddad, as you have heard over and over, was a very disciplined person. Dad had a routine for everything, and Stephanie joked that she could actually set her clock off him, off the various activities he did at certain times. Chad credits his discipline to his grandfather, and of course, Matthew and Jonathan likewise. As for his sons-in-law, Edwin or Bunny, as we call him, and Stephen, life with Dad was one continuous joke, as he came up with the most clever jokes that we could think of, and he tried to outdo them. But along with the jokes came the wisdom that they say they benefited from. As a matter of fact, Edwin, who is a photographer in his own right, approves of the picture on display. That half smile or half grin, he says, reflects the mischief, the jokes, reflects the jokes that was always part of interacting with Daddy. Now, Daddy decided that he was going to teach his children some special skills. He had a good grasp of the English language, honed by his time in England. and he always spoke the Queen's English. He therefore insisted that all his children followed suits. While we sometimes did not live up to the expectation, that expectation, we tried. His handwriting was second to none. As a matter of fact, when I saw his failing years, I would ask Daddy to sign his name, and those papers right now are the most precious things to me. He had a signature that was so distinct, as he told us that in his day, penmanship was a subject. Daddy was a strong swimmer, I guess no surprise, as he grew up in Port Antonio. And he decided that all of us had to learn to swim. He didn't have much luck with Mom, as she does not pass the water, would should not pass her knees. But with us, we had to learn to swim. Mark remembers Daddy teaching him that he should walk with a sense of purpose and have a firm handshake. And finally, we mention Mommy. Auntie Peggy, his life and ministry partner for 63 years. Mommy never left his side. It took a lot of sacrifice, as you can imagine, on her side. Mommy was the glue, or is, continues to be the glue that holds everything together. And as we move from station to station and assignment to assignment, Mommy made sure that these moves did not break us, but made us into the people that we are. Mommy, a cook and hostess, homemaker par excellence, her hospitality ministry complemented Daddy's. As many persons, many of you who are here today, I'm sure, can personally attest to that. In Daddy's later years, his life was filled with prayer. We would hear Daddy praying from all over the house. He would pray for persons. As a matter of fact, I think the last thing he was able to do was to pray for the nurses who took care of him. We would hear Daddy saying, "Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God," on almost a minutely basis. My co-worker, who is here today, on hearing him, declared that God is really close to your father. He's your best friend. And so I would like to read a poem penned by Mommy, who is, by the way, in the process of writing her eighth book. Tribute to my husband. He lived his life to give kindness and love that flowed through him from the Father above. He lived his life trusting God's grace that in heaven he would find a place. He lived his life to care for and help the poor and needy, to give them hope so that they may not grow weary. He lived his life to show others he cared, and the word of God with them he shared. He lived his life to give glory to God. He lived his life to praise God, surely. For his heart and voice he would always raise and glorify him all his earthly days. Now he was getting old, and the hairs on his head were getting gray. But he still gave God praises every day. He would shout and sing, "Yes, God is good, today, tomorrow, and forever." Amen.
So, brothers and sisters, as we close, we would like to use this opportunity to thank you all for coming here today. to celebrate Dad's life. And I know you all came from far and near. We'd like to thank all the circuits who are represented here. And although I will not take a roll call, I know there are many circuits and many of you who traveled from far away, and we thank you. We thank our church family for your prayerful support. We thank the Connectional Bishop, the District Bishop and her team, and thanks to the Reverend Maxine Forrest Edwards and members of the Wesley Church. We thank Miss Lisa Simpson in the office and, of course, the support staff here at the church who could prepare the sanctuary for us. And so this morning as well, we'd also like to thank the sound person, Mr. Christopher Reed. We also like to thank the audiovisual team, and that they are from Axiom Limited, for the great quality we know others are enjoying who are not here. And in that same vein, I'd like to welcome and thank those who are online, watching and worshiping along with us. And so, we also give thanks to the, or say thank you, to the JDF. I'm not certain if they're here as yet, but they will be, they're here. We thank the JDF. Thank you so much for coming to help us to celebrate Dad's life. Additionally, we'd like to thank those who made his life more comfortable before he transitioned. So we thank doctors Dave Hansen and Christine Carberry. We thank the team of nurses at the Villa Road Home for Senior Citizens. And we also thank the doctors and nurses of the Hargreaves Memorial Hospital. And before we go any further, we also like to just give a little word of thanks to Chief Justice Brian Sykes, also a member of the family who journeyed with the to be here. I'm sorry to single you out, sir, but but we thank the musicians as well, and we also have to thank our soloists. Mr. Leroy Heron has done his part, and of course we have Canon Grace coming up. And of course, Mr. Heron told you that he was one of the young people in the St. Thomas circuit at the time. So, we'd also like to thank, and it would be reminiscent of me if I didn't thank, our co-workers who are here. We have representatives from the Sickle Cell Unit, the University of the West Indies, where I am part of the staff there. And I'd really like to thank my director and Professor Asnani, Monica Asnani, Mrs. Karen Aldred, and also Professor Jennifer Knight Madden, who made the journey here. We'd also like to thank the members of the Alpart group who are here, and that is where Andreen works. And we'd like to thank members of the Stallion group from Taylor Hall, of course, coming to support Lindley. All right, so so I'm hoping that you all feel that we appreciate you. I hope I haven't left anyone out. The choir. Thank you so much. Today's a little bit of a stressful day, as Stephen warned us that it was going to be stressful. It is in a little bit. So we just like to close as we say together. May Daddy's soul rest in peace and light perpetual shine up on him. Tetelestai.
Just to ensure that that word tetelestai, which is his favorite, one of his favorite expressions, it means it is finished. But we can also know that it means it is accomplished, tetelestai.
Brothers and sisters, I am the Anglican who sang in the Methodist youth band. Well, not only that, I practically lived in the manse because Lindley with Yvonne, Uncle Lindley and Aunt Peggy were parents and mentors to every young person and their neighbor in Marant Bay. And so today, I share a song at the request of Aunt Peggy, which I do believe captures the essence of his life and vocation. May he rest in peace and rise in glory.
You.
as we have listened to tributes in song, tributes given in words, we bring this section of our service to an end, tribute section that is, and we do it now with flowers. How this is going to be done, the family will first make their tributes, floral tributes. They will place the flowers in the receptacle on the left, and the others who will follow to give their tributes will place theirs in the receptacle on the right. So the floral display will now take precedence. It's the garden with the urn, which is the floral display. While that is being done, we will sing. We say goodbye with flowers, and it's to the tune, "O Come, Let Us Adore Him."
With God's peace, till we meet.
come with me. Together, the one who didn't want me to say it, Mimi Brown with the Shet Pan, advised me to say that. And so we say goodbye with flowers, with God's love, and with God's peace. We give us all an opportunity to rise and stretch our legs while we receive the offering. One of the things I really like about this picture of Uncle Lindley, that salute, you know, it reminds us of that military preparation he had, and this hymn is appropriate. We are Christian soldiers. Onward, Christian soldiers marching to war. So as we receive an offering for the Ministerial Training Fund and the Jamaica National Children's Home, we stand and sing, Onward, Christian soldiers. Voices now. The sign of triumph, Satan's host of flee. On then, Christian soldiers, on to victory. Hell's foundations quiver at the shout of Conrad, lift your voices, love your anthems, and everybody sings, Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as war, with the cross of Jesus, going on. The women's voices now. Thank you.
Uncle Lindley, Daddy, Grandpa. We thank you, Lord, for these gifts that have been received. And Lord God, we pray that as we use these gifts for the purposes for which they were accepted, give us wisdom, give us strength. Lord, we pray that as we give our gifts to you, you will accept us, Lord, as we offer ourselves as living sacrifice to you and consecrate our lives to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We turn now to the ministry of the word. Our Old Testament reading, 1 Kings chapter 2, 1 through 12, by Pastor Edwin Jones, followed by the responsive Psalm 23 by Dr. Stephanie Scott Mullins, and then the epistle, Mr. Matthew Jones, and the gospel reading by Reverend Stephen Mullins.
Old Testament reading is taken from 1 Kings chapter 2 and reading from verse 1 to verse 12. When David's time to die drew near, he charged his son Solomon, saying, "I am about to go the way of all the earth. Be strong, be courageous, and keep the charge of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and keeping his statutes, his commandments, his ordinances, and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, so that you may prosper in all that you do and wherever you turn. Then the Lord will establish his word that he spoke concerning me. If your hairs have heed to their way, to walk before me in faithfulness with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail your successor on the throne of Israel. Moreover, you know also what Job, the son of Zeruiah, did to me, how he dwelt with the two commanders of the armies of Israel, Abner, the son of Ner, and Amasa, the son of Jethro, whom he murdered, retaliating in the time of peace for blood that had been shed in war, and putting the blood of war on the belt around his waist and on the sandals on his feet. Act therefore according to your wisdom, but do not let his gray head go down to Sheol in peace. Deal loyally, however, with the sons of Barzillai, the Gileadite, and let them be among those who eat at your table. For with such loyalty they met me when I fled from your brother Absalom. There is also with you Shemini, the son of Gia, the Benjaminite from Berhurim, who cursed me with a terrible curse on the day when I met Mahim Miniam. But when he came down to meet me at the Jordan, I swear to him by the Lord, I will not put you to death with the sword. Therefore, do not hold him guiltless, for you are a wise man. You will know what you ought to do to him, and you must bring him his gray head down with blood to Sheol. Then David slept with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. The time that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned for 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat at the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was firmly established. The word of the Lord.
The responsive reading is taken from Psalm 23. I invite you to read alternate verses. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He restoreth my soul. He leads me in the right paths for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Please stand for the Gloria. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, so now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. The epistle is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, reading from verses. So, for those who didn't hear, good afternoon, everyone. The epistle is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, reading from verses 15 to 58. What I am saying, brothers and sisters, is this: flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable body must put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Here in the reading of God's holy word.
I invite you all to please stand and please, I'm going to step a little out of what I would call convention, because knowing Lindley Conrad Rankine the way that I knew him, I am led to ask us all here today to just wave our hands in the air and say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
God is good.
All the time.
God is good. Now listen to the gospel
according to John chapter 11, verse 17 to verse 27. Glory to you, O God. Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. But when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." But Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." This is the gospel of Christ.
The chancel choir will minister to us now in song. After the selection, we will hear the words of comfort from our connectional bishop, the Reverend Everell Galbraith, and in order to prepare our hearts to receive his message, we will be singing the chorus, "Spirit of the Living God," the chancel choir.
Thank you. Thank you. Bishop Christine Goodman-Gouche, colleagues in ministry, Aunt Peggy, and the other members of the bereaved family, brothers and sisters here gathered and those online, good afternoon. On behalf of our connectional officers, Reverend Liddell, Mrs. Smith, Dr. Marquette, our conference office staff, Sister Shireen, and indeed the entire MCCA family, I express condolences on the passing of Reverend Lindley Conrad Rankine. The earthly journey of a very special soldier of the cross has ended. On Monday 8th, April 24, a young adult from one of our circuits sent me a text, and in that text she wrote, and I quote, "Reverend Rankine is one of three ministers who has impacted my life," end of quote. And we have heard today that there are many more like her. As a fellow Cliff College graduate myself, we had many conversations about Cliff College and his time there and my time there. He also taught me quite a few lessons when I visited them. He taught me about humility in ministry, as he and Sister Peggy shared with me their refrigerator when they worked in Mountainside, St. Elizabeth. What was it? A hole in the ground, packed with ice. It was they who encouraged me, maybe the first to have done so, and advised me how to acquire a home early in my ministry. Thank God, my wife and I obeyed. His life was characterized by love, generosity, and humility. Have you ever seen or heard Uncle Lindley laugh? Well, I can just imagine the laughter that is taking place in the great beyond between Uncle Lindley, Roy White, Dennis Magnus, and William Watty. Reverend Wright and I visited him on the 24th of February of this year. There was no verbal communication. We sang and we prayed. And when we were about to depart and we said goodbye, we received from him a heartwarming smile. It remains with me. He was one of a kind. One of a kind. In preparation for this celebration, the Holy Spirit inserted in my thoughts and mind two verses from Scripture. One from 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 10, which says, "Then David rested with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David." David rested with his ancestors. And also from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, where Paul said, "Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. I've entitled the message this afternoon, Walking in Hope. Walking in Hope. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for this moment when we can reflect on the life of our brother, your servant, your child, your son, Lindley. We thank you, God, for the great examples he has left for us and the impact he has had on so many of us. I ask you now, O God, to speak through me and to speak to us. Help us, O God, to hear whatever message you have for us today, and may we be willing to obey your guidance for Christ's sake. Amen. It seems to me, Brother Godfrey, who is not at the keyboard, that we need to sing one verse of Master Speak, Thy Servant Heareth.
Thy gracious word, longing for thy voice that cheereth, Master, let it now be heard.
I'm listening. Lord, for thee. Gives us courage and determination to give wholehearted attention and commitment to what we do. The two passages I read assure us that Uncle Lindley is resting with his ancestors and that all he did for the cause of Christ will be rewarded. Paul's view about the resurrection and hope explains Paul's wholehearted devotion to the Christian life and ministry. Paul's letter to the Corinthians was intended to bring the believers back into line with Orthodox faith and practice, and to ensure that those who died, and to assure them that those who died will still benefit from the promises of God. You see, in the church in Corinth, resurrection was a bone of contention. Some in the church denied the reality of the resurrection. In verse 12 of chapter 15, Paul says, quote, "Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead?" How? So Paul went on to say, quote, "If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation is in vain, and our faith is in vain." End of quote. And Paul then spent the remainder of the chapter declaring, arguing and defending the doctrine of the resurrection and laying a solid foundation for theirs and our hope as believers. Paul's conclusion which is our text, touches on the hope we enjoy as children of God and on what that hope accomplishes in our lives. This message, my brothers and sisters, can help us to dedicate ourselves to walking before the Lord and serving God with audacious and absolute hope. Today, we thank God for Lindley Conrad, who gave years of faithful and sacrificial service to the church and the world. He loved God. He loved his family. He loved people. His life and ministry were motivated by an audacious and absolute confidence and hope in God. He was propelled and strengthened by his conviction that God loved him with an everlasting and unconditional love, and that nothing in the temporal or spiritual realm could separate him from God's love. Now he has gone the way of his ancestors and all mortals. My dear sisters and brothers in Christ, colleagues in ministry, bereaved family members, death can cause us to despair, and our hopelessness can stifle our desire to serve God. We can resign from our responsibilities and retire on the job because of death. When it has come and taken our loved ones, it can really put a wrench in our lives. We can even be tempted to say, what's the use? However, the resurrection of Jesus assures us that weeping may endure for the night, but the night will not last forever. Joy comes in the morning. So regardless of our current circumstances, God's message to us is, therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. And so this speaks to the people of hope, the power of hope, the pledge of hope. Let us look at these as we continue to reflect. The people of hope. Of hope. Who are the people of hope? Paul calls them my beloved brothers and sisters. These are the people who received Jesus, who believed in his name, and have become sons and daughters of God, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Not just believers in Corinth, but the saints of all the ages. Paul was speaking about Peter and Thomas Cook and Mother Teresa and William Carey and Evans Bailey and Hyacinth Booth and Lindley Rankine and you and me. Yes, people of hope. all who are born again, who are saved from sin by the amazing grace of God and brought into a personal faith relationship with Jesus Christ. We are, hallelujah, we are people of hope. We are. The people of hope are destined for glory. Paul assures us that God has something, some big things waiting for the people of hope. Whether we depart by means of death or the rapture, we possess hope of a brighter, better future. In fact, the Bible tells us that no eyes have seen, no ears have heard what God has in store for those who love and serve him. Uncle Lindley believed it. He lived it. He preached it. My friends, things may not be as good as you'd like them to be. However, don't lose heart. And don't become hopeless, but continue pressing forward. Like our Uncle Lindley, who has gone before us, let us also fight the good fight of faith. Let us keep the faith. Let us finish the race with confidence and absolute hope. Because if we believe in Jesus, we are children of God and we are the people of hope. And secondly, the power of hope. Paul, if you notice, employs the word therefore. And therefore links us back to all that he said before. The hope is a motivator to spiritual action for the glory of God. You see, my friends, being saved, sure and secure, does not mean that we just sit back, relax, rest, and await the rapture or death. It does not. We are saved to serve. Being saved means that we are to get to work for the glory of God. The resurrection of Jesus is a powerful motivator for service because it tells us that all is not lost, and because God is in control, all will be well. That's what the resurrection says. I want to remind us that belief always affects behavior. And so knowing and believing the right things about Jesus and the future will cause us to get busy for the glory of God. Reverend Rankine believed that God loves the world, and that salvation has been secured and is available to everyone. He believed that everyone can be saved, and everyone can know they are saved, and that everyone can be saved to the utmost. He believed it, and was an avid worker in God's vineyard. He was determined to spend and be spent so that those who are being lost can be rescued. His service was inspired by Fanny Crosby's most loved and powerful hymn, "Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave." He was not unwilling to take the gospel to the streets, to the highways and the byways. so that others can hear and be saved. All God's children can be motivated by the power of hope. Our service, my sisters and brothers, should depend on the stability and firmness in our convictions. We ought to be firmly situated in our personal convictions about God and God's love for the world. Because you see, if we are not too certain, then it will impact negatively our efforts at reaching others for Christ. We need to believe it with our whole heart. When our hope is real, it causes us to be stable in our faith and to walk unwaveringly. When we are firmly rooted and grounded in our belief, we will not allow anything to move us from our determination to serve the Lord. The challenges and pressures will be there. They will always be there. But they should not cause us to work to rule. Come what may, we should be willing to go beyond the call of duty, to go the extra mile, to go overboard in our work for God. We heard it about Uncle Lindley. That's a man who, from all that we have heard, went overboard in his work for God. Whenever the church called upon him in challenging times and situations, he responded. And he did that until he could do that no more. Many servants of God, right here, are what I call abounders. Abounders. And many who died were abounders. In other words, they were on fire for God. And they went overboard. They went the extra mile to do things in the name of God. John Wesley, Eric Bailey, Julia Davis, Lindley Rankine. Abounders. And I believe God wants all of us, those who are his children in this world, to be abounders, to be willing to go above and beyond in and for the sake of Christ, to do what we can. The power comes from the hope of the resurrection. And thirdly and finally, the pledge of hope. The pledge of hope. If this life is all there is, if there is no hope of eternity, no rapture, no resurrection, if all we have to look forward to is the cold grave, then there is reason to despair. There is. But not so fast. Not so fast. Paul sounds out the blessed truth that there is a resurrection. And Jesus himself said it before, on the occasion of Lazarus' death and him being raised from, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. There is resurrection, he said. Jesus Christ himself rose from the dead. He walked out of the grave. He walked out of the dark domain. And he lives forever to reign. He lives. And he is our great example. And he has set the tone and the pace for us. Therefore, death is not the end, because Jesus has, by his death, put death to death. Amen? Amen? He has. And so the hope of the resurrection gives us confidence. Paul says in his lesson, we know that our work for Jesus matters. There is no sacrifice. There is no struggle. There is no self-denial, no valley, no work for God that goes unnoticed and unrewarded. None. Paul encouraged the believers to keep praying, keep serving, keep living for Jesus, because what God's children do in God's name, great or small, is not in vain. Your labor, he said, is not in vain. Even if others don't believe you, even if others don't receive the message, it will not be a waste of time or an exercise in futility. You see, God sees all, and God knows all. The proverb said, Proverbs 15, verse 3, the eyes of the Lord are everywhere, keeping watch on the wicked and the good. His eyes are everywhere. So it doesn't matter if people believe you when you tell them God loves you. Your responsibility is to tell them God loves you. Amen? Amen? That's your responsibility. And in Revelation 22, verse 12, we are told that, quote, God knows it all, and God will repay according to everyone's work. God will repay according to everyone's work. So the reward will be there in God's own time. This hope also gives us consolation. And I say consolation because sometimes the road we walk is rocky and steep and hard. Do I have an amen? Sometimes it's hard. And they say it's hard like hell. Sometimes the burdens we bear are heavy. Sometimes the work we are called to do seems endless, seems unappreciated, seems unrewarding. Sometimes. And sometimes Christians can be rough, you know. Christians can be rough, but we must go on, labor on. The hymn says, toil on, and in your toil rejoice, because for toil comes rest, for exile home. Yes. When the work is hard and thankless, walk in confidence, because the Lord is watching. And when God comes, God will reward you. I don't believe Uncle Lindley always had it easy. But in humility and love, he continued to give his personal best for Jesus. He did. And friends, when we walk with God, when we work for God, when we wait patiently for God, the day will come when God will say, Well done. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. I believe that Uncle Lindley will hear those words. Well done. And I hope and pray that every one of us here, when our journey on this earth comes to an end, as it will one day, maybe soon, we will hear the Savior say, well done, well done. It was William Shakespeare in conclusion who made a very compelling summary of how mortals go about their daily lives, interacting with one another. He said, and I quote, all the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances. And one man in his time play many parts, end of quote. Like David, Linda Rankin has played his part with confident hope and made his exit. He's gone to his eternal reward. We too should give our all to Jesus' cause, because we are the people of hope. We have the power of hope, and we have a pledge of hope. And our labor for the Lord is not in vain. Labor on, my sisters and my brothers. Whatever it is that God has put into your hands to do, do it well. Do it well. Rest in peace, Uncle Lindley. And rise in glory. Amen. Let us pray. And so, God, we thank you for the words of encouragement today, even as we think about your Son, whom you have called home. He has left us good examples from which we can learn to be better servants and to make greater contributions in this world. We ask you, God, to help each one of us, those you have called into full-time ministry, those who are involved in lay ministry in the church, those, oh God, who have not yet found what it is that you want them to do. We pray that you will help us all to know your will for our lives and to do the best we can. Because, Lord, what we know for sure is that what you want and expect from us is not what others can do, but our personal best. That's why you said to the disciples who were complaining about the woman who anointed you, leave her alone. She has done what she could. Lord God, help each one of us to do what we can for you, knowing that one day we will receive our well done. For Christ's sake, amen. Let us stand as we affirm our faith in God in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
sung it so well in the last five verse hymn. So in this one, we'll ask all the women to sing the second verse by yourselves, and the men the third verse. And we can listen to each other, listen to the words, because they are meaningful words. This is why we often refer this to this as the Methodist anthem. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Let's sing to God's glory.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. Please be seated while I ask the family and relatives of Reverend Rankine to remain standing. Let us pray. Comforting God, as we gather in this hallowed place, our hearts heavy with sorrow yet lifted by the hope of eternal life, we come before you with bowed heads and humble hearts. We thank you for the life of your faithful son and servant Lindley Conrad Rankine, who has now completed the race and entered into your glorious presence. Now, Lord, we lift up Reverend Rankine's family before you today. Surround them with your comfort and peace, that peace which surpasses all understanding. In their grief, be their strength. In their sadness, be their solace. Wrap your loving arms around them and remind them of your promise to never leave them nor forsake them. Mighty God, we pray for Yvonne, Auntie Peggy, his widow, all their children, and the extended family. May they find refuge in your unfailing love and comfort in the precious memories they shared with your son, Lindley. Grant them the grace to navigate this season of loss with faith and trust in your sovereign plan. Lord, we also pray for the legacy of faith and the ministry that Uncle Lindley leaves behind. May his example of dedication, service, and love continue to inspire and impact generations to come. May his family find strength in knowing that your son's work on earth was not in vain, but has left an indelible mark on countless lives. And so as we celebrate Uncle Lindley's life today, help us as part of his larger family to honor his memory by living lives that reflect your love and your grace. May we be reminded of the brevity of life and the importance of living each day with purpose and passion for your kingdom. And now, Lord, we entrust the family of Lindley and Yvonne into your loving care, knowing that you are the God of all comfort and the healer of broken hearts. May your presence be their constant companion, guiding them through the days ahead until they are united with Uncle Lindley, your son, into your heavenly kingdom. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We continue in prayer, the prayer of thanksgiving. Praise be to you, O God our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, and are now seated at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, O Holy Spirit, God our Comforter, who bear witness within us of our acceptance with the Father and have become the pledge of our eternal inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O Blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We bless your name for the life of Lindley, whom we today lay to rest. We give you thanks for the joy and the blessing that his life has brought to others, for his service to his generation according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of his life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness, which have followed him all the days of his life, that now the trials of this world are over and death itself is past. Receive him into your perfect kingdom and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite us to stand, please. Eternal God, who have made us all and hate nothing that you have made, and have given your Son for our redemption, we commend our brother, your son, Lindley Conrad, to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto him, and let light perpetual shine upon him. And as our Savior taught us, we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, and thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And just before we sing the closing hymn, immediately after, this is one of Uncle's hymn, All Praise to Our Redeeming Lord, in particular the last verse. And if our fellowship below in Jesus be so sweet, what heights of rapture shall we know when round his throne we meet? Just allow me, on behalf of the family, to extend thanks for the presence of Reverend Oliver Daly and Reverend Anthony Chung and the members from the United Church of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, and also to say thanks to the family, those who are here from the UTCWI family, both the tutor wardens, the president of UTCWI, and the students who are our ministers in training. And of course, Reverend Leslie Anderson is online, and he has asked to be identified with this service, as well as Reverend Hugo Ray and Reverend Daryl Barrow. We sing the hymn, All Praise to Our Redeeming Lord, and then our connectional bishop will pronounce the benediction.
Thank you.
Now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
We are going to be inviting now the Jamaica Defense Force, the last post. We remain standing for the recessional, but just by way of instructions, as we recess, oh, we are to do 1 minute silence. I'm sorry. Okay. The family invites you to share in a repast just immediately following this service and after the recession. I should just make note of the fact that the Reverend Kathy Gale, who is also watching online and would like to also, would have had us convey her sympathy to Auntie Peggy and the rest of the family, and to say that as we worked together to prepare this order and the tribute, I would like to say thank you, particularly to one of the grandchildren who assisted in compiling the tribute book, and that is Angelique Mullins. Thank you so much, Angelique. We are now going to have the recession.
Many tears and sorrow, I've had questions for tomorrow. There've been times I didn't know right from wrong, but in every situation God gave me blessed consolation. that my trials come to only make me strong. I've been a lot of places, and I've seen millions of faces, but there were times that I felt so all alone. But in my lonely hour, yet those precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know that I was his own. That's the reason I say that through it all, through it all, oh, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Let me tell you, through it all, through it all, oh, I've learned to depend upon his word.
Live stream services provided by Axiom Pictures Limited, located at 1C Braemar Avenue, Kingston 10. Call us at 876-615-4256. Axiom Pictures Limited, superior quality for lasting memories. His word.
I've had many tears and sorrow, I've had questions for tomorrow. There've been times I didn't know right from wrong, but in every situation God gave me blessed consolation, that my trials come to only make me strong. I've been a lot of places, and I've seen millions of faces, but there were times that I felt so all alone. But in my lonely hour, yet those precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know that I was his own. That's the reason I say that through it all, trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Let me tell you, through it all, through it all, oh, I've learned to depend upon his word. Live stream services provided by Axiom Pictures Limited, located at 1C Braemar Avenue, Kingston 10. Call us at 876-615-4256. Axiom Pictures Limited, superior quality for lasting memories. His word.